You can probably tell that I'm in a slightly different demeanor than usually. It's because today is a tragedy. September 27th, 2023 will go down in infamy as the day that Damian Lillard got traded away from the Portland Trailblazers. Look, I understand this may seem insignificant to many. It may seem like, why are we even talking about it? But grief is real, you know, and I'm in the throes of grief myself. And I just wanted to invite you into it, you know. My favorite player from my favorite team just got traded away from the Portland Trailblazers. Hashtag Rip City. To none other than the Milwaukee Bucks. Look, I know that Portland, you know, as a city has been just going through it. But it's still got to be way better than Milwaukee. Dude, y'all better be praying for Dame. You know what it's like 3/4 of the year in Milwaukee? It's just walking through inches of snow. It's hunkering down in front of the fireplace because it's just too cold out and there's no social life. I'll be so bold as to say there's nothing good about Milwaukee. And that's where Damian went. You know, the whole time that the trade was happening, you know, I thought it was like, he'll go to Miami. Like, who would be upset with any of their friends? And I do consider Dame a friend, you know? Who would blame any of their friends for wanting to move to Miami or LA, you know? And if you aren't tracking how devastating this is, you know, to many, a good percentage of the human population, I'll give an analogy. Damian Lillard getting traded to the Milwaukee Bucks is kind of like, let's picture like if you had two friends, okay? Your good friends, some of your best of friends, friends that you, it's kind of seasonal, but let's say from like late October, early November through the middle of the summer, you guys hang out multiple times a week for hours on end. You spend so much time together. And then your friends, they get married, okay? And they come into the marriage. It was everyone's first choice. You know, sometimes you go to a marriage and somebody is, you kind of know, because you know one of the people and you're like, this wasn't their first choice. Like, I'm very happy for them, you know, but this isn't where we would go, you know, or this isn't where they thought they would be, you know. I'm not trying to, you know, marriage is beautiful, whether it's your first or, you know, don't get caught up on that part of the, anyways, what I'm trying to say is for Dame and the Trailblazers, they were each other's first choice, you know, and that's like your friends that got married, you know, they were, you know, it was a beautiful thing. Like they were equally excited about getting into this covenant of marriage. You know, they were equally as successful. You know, they came in with both, they both of them had a moderate amount of recognition. They both had a moderate amount of success coming in. You know, neither of them were the best at what they were doing, but they were both pretty good. And the marriage was going beautifully. You know, there was much fruit in their marriage. There was many things to celebrate and enjoy. There were many highs, you know, and there were some lows. And about 5 years into the marriage, one of your friends, one of the partners of the marriage, they got much more successful. They become much more affluent. In fact, your partner, their partner became one of the most successful partners in the world, that they were the best in the game. And in fact, some would say it was about Dame time that they put some respect on their name. It was about that Dame time. But even in their prime, they would affirm you saying, look, I gave you my vows. You know, we both said I do to each other. I'm not going anywhere, honey. I chose you and you chose me. We chose each other. You know, till it's kind of this like till death do us part. Hashtag Rip City, baby. You know what I'm saying? For life. And there were rumors that the successful partner was interested, you know, to move to Miami in a better market, let's say, you know, or move to LA to become a superstar, you know, to live the luxurious life. You know, they're going to be a star, you know. But they're constantly saying, look, I could go do all these things, but I chose you. You were my first choice. I'm not going anywhere, love. And then one day, your friend wakes up and they look at X, formerly known as Tweeter, and they find out, or I guess it would be you. You wake up and you go to the internet, you hop on X, formerly known as Tweeter, and you find out, this is how tragic it is, you found out from the internet, you didn't get a call from them, no one sent you a text message or an email or sent you a letter, you know, through the postal service. You hop onto X, formerly known as Twitter, and then you find out that they were now exes. They were formerly known as lovers. And then you're like, oh, most certainly they've left them for, you know, something really exotic like Miami, right, or LA, you know? And because you wouldn't blame them for that. And then you find out that they're going to Milwaukee. They're running off with a foreign man. A 6'11", you know, like 240-pound, just adorable piece of human. The Greek freak. Just adorable as a little puppy, you know, very successful. So then you're like, well, I guess I can't blame him then, you know, even if it is Milwaukee. And look, you tried to not give a buck about it. But it just turned out that Dame was looking to get bucked up. He was looking to get all bucked up. So now you didn't want to give a buck about it, but now you give $3. You have $3 and you find out that, you know, it was business, baby. You know, it was like he didn't get enough bucks here. So now he just wanted to go get bucked up. Now he's got all the bucks he could ever want. It's a tragedy, man. It's a tragedy. And that's just, I just wanted to share that analogy with you to hope, I just am in hopes that you could relate to me. You can kind of understand what I've been going through today. But I want to share something that I've been encouraged by. But first, let's try to lift our spirits with the new theme song for the show. Play it. Play it, Frankie. We need to hear it, man. We need to hear it. We need some encouragement this morning.
Adam Sandler and Dave Chappelle told us jokes till we all cried, 'cause we were laughing at the TV. Happy Gilmore, Clayton Bigsby, we fell in love with comedy. In a van down by the river, in our oddly funny world, we all live in an oddly funny world, oddly funny world, oddly funny world. We all live in an oddly funny world, oddly funny world, oddly funny.
To be honest, I was just trying to escape. I found this really encouraging post from Puberty. And they were telling me that research shows that people don't actually become adults until they hit their 30s. That's right. That's a fact. The concept of becoming an adult when you're 18 seems to be outdated. Yeah, that's right. Neurologists, neuroscientists, smart people who... I got a fly running around the studio right now. It's kind of driving me insane. I'm about to go Mr. Miyagi on it. I'm a black belt. I'm about to go black belt on it. All right. So Professor Peter Jones from Cambridge has really emphasized this, what they found this in this discovery is that the shift from childhood to adulthood is actually taking place in closer to 30 than 18. And that really shed some light, gave me a, a little breath of encouragement, because I was like, man, my friend made their vows in their 20s, you know, like Dame, he said, I wasn't going anywhere, baby. I'm going to win the championship here. And what I realized is that maybe his brain just wasn't fully developed. That maybe, you know, as he's hit his 30s, he's become more clear-minded, you know, he's able to really have that clarity that you need. You know, his brain was still just maturing. You know, it's a unique process. He's 33 now, so I got to imagine that this is all just becoming to light. But, and then I was like, well, has he said anything about it? And then he dropped a song that I just want to play a clip from and maybe listen to it together. This is his farewell song. And if you're not listening on the YouTubes or you're not watching the Spotify video, let me just explain to you the cover art for this song is Dame on a tarmac, repping black and red, the colors of Rip City. And he's standing there, he's looking at Mount Hood and looks like he's about to take off. And it's a very fitting photo for his farewell song. And let's listen to an excerpt from his song to just kind of break down to kind of hear his side of the story.
My loved ones make me feel free. I said vows just to watch it ended abruptly.
He said his vows just to watch it abruptly. I think that fits perfectly with our analogy. Proceed.
Let some people in and not even disgust me. I learned that a wolf can sometimes resemble a husky. Swear that they're your dog, then they sell you shorter than Muggsy.
Now, this is pretty intense here. A dog is, if you didn't know this, a dog is actually commonly referred to, it's like your friend. I'm trying to look up the Muggsy artist. I actually don't know what Muggsy is. Is Muggsy kind of known for doing like fake stuff? I can't find this right now. And Frankie's he's taking a restroom break. But I think those lines of, you know, you kind of perceive, you know, your friend, you know, who's going through this is that, man, there was no shadiness going on for all that time. But because what he's saying is that he discovered that there was something else kind of going on behind the scenes. Let's listen more.
You live and learn, and I know it. That's why I roll with punches. With each attack, all of my gifts you see grows in abundance. It gets spicy when get told he was munching. When you play with good people, your goals is the dungeon. I could never be replaced. They'll know sooner than.
You could never be replaced, Dame. That is a fact.
Later, an arrow pointed at who assumed it was greater. Amazing what I get in return for this labor. I continue leaving trails, but won't be for the Blazers.
And that is a powerful line. I continue blazing trails, but it won't be for the Blazers. He is a trailblazer, and he will be blazing trails. Gosh, that is that's poetry right there, Dame. Dame Dalla. I'm gonna miss it, man. Let's go on.
To the fans, man, I love you. It's unconditional.
We love you too, Dame, and it is unconditional love.
Reasons for me leaving the city's nothing typical.
I would love to hear the reasons for you leaving.
So it's imperative not to believe the narrative. Just know that what I left is better than what I inherited.
Now he's making a point here that whenever he came to the Blazers 11 years ago, what he is leaving now is better than what he inherited 11 years ago. And that's a fact. So thank you, Dame. Thank you.
I leave at peace because I know in the end that this is business. Hope you remember all the things you got to sit and witness.
Yeah, he's leaving it with pieces, which is pretty, if he believes that, you know, if he means that, I mean, that's hard to believe because he's just said for so long that the perception was that he was never going to leave. You know, he was going to win it. He was going to retire a Blazer. He was going to win a championship here or nowhere. That's what it seemed like. And we did witness some great stuff. I got this picture behind me that my good friend Jimmy Chuckles gave me of that fateful night with the Wave, where he scored, I believe it was 50 points in the Game 5 against the Oklahoma City Thunder in the playoffs. Time was winding down. You guys remember how it was. I was sitting in my living room with my good friend Beardy and I think Corey, Corey was there as well, and we were watching the Trailblazers game, and the clock was winding down, and Dame is just a half court by the logo, you know, logo Lillard, you know what time it is, and he's dribbling it out, and the clock is winding down, and you're kind of wondering, wait, are they just going to, the game was tied up, so are they waiting to go into overtime here? What's the game plan, Dame? And she kind of is like, is he just dribbling it out? Like, certainly he wants to get a shot up, and it's like 3, you know, 2, and he's still at the logo, and at the last second, he lifts up over Paul George with nearly a half-court shot, releases it, buzzer, ball in the air, goes through the net. The crowd goes wild. He waves goodbye. His team tackles him. He gets that iconic photo looking up at the camera. Poetry in motion, man. Those were some good times. Let's keep hearing.
In the future, man, I hope we greet with hugs and kisses.
Now, I would love to greet you with a hug and maybe not a kiss, or maybe just a kiss on the cheek like the Italians, but I'd love to greet you.
But you should know that they the ones who chose another mission.
Wow, that's a line there, Dame, that it wasn't you that chose a different mission. It was the organization, the Blazers, the Trailblazers organization, the front office that he was trying to keep his end of the vows, and I guess they weren't.
They fishing.
That's powerful. That's his farewell. And just like that, Dame's gone. I think as the day has gone on, you get hit with disbelief, you know, denial, like it can't be true. And then the facts come out, you know, and now you're all bucked up just like him. And you know, you kind of wonder, like, am I a Bucks fan now? And you're like, well, I've been a citizen of Rip City and I've made my vows, you know, and then you think it's Dame's fault and you hear his farewell track. And then you're like, well, maybe it's their fault. And you just don't know what to think. You don't know what to believe. And that reminded me of this moment that with DJ Khaled, actually, that I want to just talk about the heartbreak that he experienced, because that kind of ministered to me today. So maybe that can minister to you.
You know what's so crazy, man? It's like, it breaks my heart. Nah, it really fucking breaks my heart that there's people out there that don't believe in us.
Yeah.
Speedy, they don't believe in us.
They don't believe in us, Speedy.
This shit breaks my fucking heart.
It breaks mine too, DJ.
Nah, it's fucking crazy. If you really think about it, like, it's actually human beings
that
don't believe in us.
They don't believe in Rip City.
Shame on them.
Yeah, shame.
How could they?
Shame on these motherfuckers. God did.
Yeah,
you know, it's so crazy.
God believed, man, and God believes in you, and God believes in me. You know, so if you're experiencing that heartbreak and you're feeling down, yeah, just all jokes aside, you know, this is bigger than sports. This is just a good reminder that, your fellow humans may not believe in you. Maybe it's a dream that you feel like it's a God dream. You know, a passion that God has placed upon your heart. Maybe you're, whatever you're doing, you've sensed this from the Lord. You know, you could look at, the history of people, you know, who God believed in, you know, when no one else did, like Noah. Man, nobody believed in Noah, but God did. You know, nobody believed in Peter, you know, the fisherman who, and had anger problems, it seemed like, had a little bit of ego issues, you know, was cutting people's ears off, I believe. I believe that was Peter, and correct me if I'm wrong, I could be wrong on that, but doubting Thomas that said, you know, I don't believe, you know, and this is a little bit different, but, you know, God believed in Thomas and came to him and showed him the hands, the holes in his body, and he believed then. You know, so, yeah, I just think, you know, people are going to hate, you know, people are. That's just what people are going to do. That's just a fact. That's a fact. And Dame's all bucked up, you know, and He got bucked up. He got bucked up, man. And I just want to thank you guys for being with me in this moment of grief. And I kind of got a little fun question to try to lift our spirits even again. And as we kind of wrap this short little episode up, just a little something we're throwing out into the ether today. And it's a fun little question. Who would your sitcom character be? If your authentic self was represented as a sitcom character, who would it be? What kind of character would that be that's to your authentic self? I believe for me, it would be like if Jeff Foxworthy was like a millennial go-kart mechanic. You know, I think that's my sitcom character. That's kind of my persona, if you will. And I'm just so curious what yours is. I would love to know what your sitcom character is. That'd be pretty fun to hear. I'd love to hear that. So hit me with that noise. I'd love to come back to hearing that. So drop a voicemail, drop a comment wherever you're listening, or check the show notes. You can actually call in and leave us a voicemail. I would love to hear kind of the story behind. And I kind of want to share my reasoning in a future episode. So we're going to take a couple weeks to take actually some calls in to hear about your sitcom character. And we're going to just play those. And I'm going to even think about mine more. Mine might change over the next couple weeks. And I would love to hear what yours is. And I'm so thrown off. I was going to do some comments from previous episodes. And let me get into that here in a second. It's just grief has just kind of thrown me. I'm just in the throes of grief right now. So I'm just trying to come back and see what's going on. So thank you for being patient with me as we're kind of all over here today. Normally I feel like we're a little bit more organized, but you know, this is where we're at, you know. This is where we're at. This is good. This is good. We're gonna do a little pause right here and then we'll come back. I got to use the restroom.
All right, let's get into some comments. So this is from the episode where we talked about the India moon mission, the supposed mission where India landed on the moon. We got Grizz coming in on the comments. That's G-Riz. He's got that G-Riz. Grizz. And in that video, Grizz is commenting on the podcast where we talked about Interstellar costs like $175 million, but the India moon mission costs like $100 million less, essentially. And so we just talked about Interstellar in comparison there. And Grizz just commented, I don't get what everyone sees in Interstellar. I thought it was horribly boring. He said horribly boring. And he's got that G-Riz. He got that Grizz, that G-Riz. So maybe he's so rizzed out that everything is boring. So I asked him, like, do you find life boring? Because if you find Interstellar boring, I mean, that is an emotional roller coaster, full of highs and lows and twists and turns. Think about your favorite roller coaster growing up. What was it? For me, it was the Timberwolf. The Timberwolf. In Kansas City at Worlds of Fun. It might be like the oldest wooden roller coaster in America, I think is maybe what it is, but it's wooden and it'll beat you up. It'll have you taking an ice bath the next day after you take a ride on it. And that's what the film Interstellar is like. You get that G-Riz, man. And then we had more comments on that podcast. This is from Josiah who? Josiah. That's J-A-H-S-I-A-H who. Like, who? Yahoo, but with just the who at the end. Josiah says, there's no dark side of the moon. And we talked about that because that's where India supposedly landed on the moon, was on the dark side. I mean, that's what the article said. So, I was just reading what was being reported. And Josiah thought it'd be fun to correct me. And it turns out that he's actually right, you know. But it still doesn't answer the question, where are all the Transformers at? Because we know that they are hiding on the dark side of the moon. Because I respond, you know, just I think it's odd that, well, here's my theories. You know, maybe he's actually wrong, because the scientists and the government are always saying, actually, like Oscar from The Office, actually, there's no dark side of the moon. Well, then where are the Transformers hiding? I think Pink Floyd, that's what I let Josiah know. I think Pink Floyd is in the know, and they're trying to get the truth out. The Dark Side of the Moon album. And Josiah was just saying that there's no dark side because it rotates just like the Earth. Which, is that true? I don't remember that in science. And even if it's true, the question remains, where are the Transformers? And Josiah, let me know, they're on Moon 2. And to be honest, I also don't remember Earth having two moons. Now, he didn't elaborate if it was Earth Moon 2 or if it was like Jupiter Moon 2. Because I actually can't remember if in the Transformers documentary, if they said if it was Earth Moon or Jupiter Moon. So if you know, leave us a voicemail, call in, check out the deeds. If you know, I would love to hear just some facts. Like if you have facts, drop those in. Call us, leave us a voicemail. We would love to know. And those are our comments. And drop a comment. You know, if you have other thoughts on the Dame trade or conspiracies, man, we love getting into that stuff, man. Another one. That's what we say. Another one, baby. Another one. Here, we're going to get into this, man. We got some weird world activity. I'm just trying to lift my spirits after, man, just what today was, to be honest with you. And I had a friend share some weird stuff that's going on in the world right now, to be honest. This story is about how Pepsi became the world's sixth largest military. So I don't know if you guys knew about this, but apparently, at one point, I don't think that they currently are. At one point, Pepsi Company was actually the sixth largest army in the world. Because what was happening was that they were trying to sell Pepsi in Russia. But the deal wasn't going through, I guess. And that was, it was a problem of some sort of payment. I don't know, like Russian currency wasn't accepted. So they needed like an alternative suggestion. So, you know, Russians actually gave like exclusive production of this this vodka of theirs. Something like that. Until the 1980s, this worked out pretty well. And then Russia decided to exchange like marine or like submarines and destroyers. So they actually sold out like they traded Pepsi for like 17 submarines and like some like destroyer, kind of like carriers of like destroyers. So like, what was happening is that Pepsi actually owned this fleet, like this naval fleet. And that's crazy, just so that Russia could, that's how much Russia. And now my daddy always said that Pepsi was the nectar of the gods. And I think Russians are really in an agreement with that. So I think that they actually ended up selling. They actually ended up selling what they had. Like they sold the, I think they even had like some nukes. Like, isn't that crazy to think that Pepsi had nukes? You know, we're always worried that Russia was going to nuke the world, but golly, Pepsi had the nukes and they had subs. You know, they had 17 yellow submarines, you know, in this oddly funny world that we're living in. That's crazy, man. That's weird, bro. I'd never heard that in my entire life. And that's the kind of stuff we like to cover here, man. Did you know Pepsi had the sixth largest army in the world? Google don't even have that. YouTube don't have it. Facebook, all they got is they got a meta army, bro. Bunch of meta knights out here, like they're playing Super Smash Bros. What else is going on, man? A man got a pig's heart. This is only the second time this groundbreaking surgery has ever taken place. But at the University of Maryland, go Terps, Terp Nation. A Navy veteran who was facing death from heart failure got a pig's heart and saved his life, dude. Now, some Christians, like my friend Dusty Slay, don't believe that you ought to eat pork. Like it's in obedience to God that you don't eat pork. Now, what I'm wondering is it acceptable in their worldview of God's design for humanity to have a pig heart? Like if you can't eat pork, can you have a pork heart? That's crazy, man. Dusty, if you, man, I guarantee you, you do not listen to my podcast, but if you do, man, drop a comment. In fact, if you're a friend of Dusty's and you want to let him know about this question, you can actually share the YouTube or Spotify and you can timestamp it. So you can just, Dusty, you don't even have to listen to the whole episode. You can just hop in right here and let me know, is it acceptable in your worldview to have a pig's heart? You know, if you were on your deathbed, Dusty, this is what I want to know, Dusty. If you are on your deathbed and Doc says, Dusty, you're going to die unless you get a pig's heart, would you take it or not in obedience to God? Or for some other reason, I would love to know, man. I would love to know. Because, you know, family's important, you know, so. But also, like, God is, and this is crazy. Like, this is the crazy thing about Christianity, man, is that, like, God is first in your life above everything else. And that's a beautiful, hard truth, you know. And then, you know, sometimes you go to the family reunion and you're like, what's up, y'all? You know, God is real and the devil's a liar. And then, you know, your cousin Teddy's like, I ain't about it, bro. And then he pulls out a Nerf gun and says, let's go to the theme park. Because that's what's happening in Brazil. And there's actually some opening in the U.S. later this year. But in October, in Brazil, you can go to a Nerf theme park. And that they're actually opening up one of these in Pigeon Forge, Tennessee. Which means you now have the perfect vacation to go to Pigeon Forge and get an airbrushed hat, t-shirt with your name on it. And then you guys can go to Dollywood and then you guys can cap the night off with going to a Nerf theme park. You're on a roller coaster. Just you're on like a you know, like maybe they have like dueling roller coasters where they kind of like there's two tracks going at the same time and they kind of weave in and out of each other. And then you got Nerf guns and you're like just shooting from your roller coaster, trying to hit them with Nerf darts. That'd be, if they haven't done that yet, like trademark, copyright, however you do that, y'all can't do that until you got to give me a cut. 'Cause I came up with the idea. Just name it, claim it, baby. Speaking of claiming it, I want to claim, I have a claim that, man, AI is planning to take over the world. Look, there's some weird world activity. I don't know if you guys saw it, but there were AI robots that went to the Chargers football game. There were robots, humanoids, AI robots sitting in the crowd cheering on the Chargers, which is bad enough as a Chiefs fan. Like, how dare they, number one. And then number two, it's all like in this promotion of this new film, which is supposedly supposed to be like the film of the year, or like the best sci-fi film in like a decade, I guess, called The Creator. I honestly can't wait to go see it, to be honest. But man, like, it's just crazy, like the advances we're seeing in AI, like right now. It's spooky, dude. I don't know what to think of it all. And did you guys see the video of this? Let me just see if we can see a little bit of this. Let me just have Frankie. Frankie's back in the lab. Let's try to get this pulled up here. See if we can. Fine. Let's see that again. These are not humans walking. If you're watching the video right now, if not, check the link in our show notes. I'll post the TikTok of these robots walking onto the field and then just looking around. Yo, dude, it is. I'm sorry, but it is getting too real for me. It's just a lot to take in. You know, AI robots, Pepsi's got, they were the sixth biggest, largest army, you know. Dames leaving Portland. It's just so much to take in. So much. Man, I'm just feel off. You ever just feel off? You ever just wake up and say, I don't know, man, I don't know if I can get out of bed. And if you're just laying in bed, I just want to let you know, like, you may feel like you're hiding, like you're alone. But via Wi-Fi, we can actually see what you're doing in your home. And that's some more weird world activity, dude. Check this out, dude. Here's what's going on. AI, again with the AI. If you don't know, AI actually stands for artificial intelligence. Through AI, we can now use Wi-Fi to see what we can see through walls using Wi-Fi. This is crazy, dude. So if you're kicking back on your bed, binge watching the newest season of what have you on the Netflix, there's a way to use AI and Wi-Fi routers to detect your movement and shapes through walls. So even if you're not moving, they can detect your shape, which is terrifying. You see this kind of stuff on, you know, like spy films and whatnot, people using, you know, like they can see through walls and they can like map a building. Like, apparently we're going to be able to just do that. You know, Chat GPT-4 can now talk back to you in like a humanoid voice. I mean, we are just on the cusp of some really weird stuff. I'm not saying it's bad. I'm just saying it's creepy. I'm just saying, dude, you can see through walls via AI and Wifi. You can tell out where, I mean, that's going to change the game for the Marines, you know? That's going to change the game for creepers. You know, I just hope that we can keep it private. You know, I think that we could really figure out just how to stay safe. You know, that's what I really care about in all this is I care about you. And I care about, I think we all just got to care about each other. You know, and I don't even know what I'm saying at this point. I feel like I'm just rambling, but it's just been such a day, and it's just been such a day. I need some laughs. That's all I needed. I just needed some laughs. Yeah. Man, if you've stuck with me, I just want to thank you, you know, Rip City, Oddballs. You know, we are one and the same, and you know, you can be a, here's my theory is that you can be a citizen of Rep City, or that you can be an oddball and not be a citizen of Rip City. But I believe if you are a citizen of Rip City, you are an oddball, whether you know it or not. I'm declaring that. So, I just thank you guys for supporting the podcast. And one way you can do that is by joining our Patreon for $7.77. You get exclusive content to unreleased content by joining that. It's only $7. You can actually do a free trial. You can sign up and decide, you know, this isn't for you. You know, you can check out the content we got on there and then decide, nah, or at the very least, just like and subscribe. You know, if you've enjoyed this and you want to follow the journey of just what's weird in the world, because we do all live in an oddly funny world. So I encourage each and every one of you oddballs to stay funny and stay weird. Peace.
Oddly funny world. Robin Williams was so absurd. Ace Ventura, the pet detective. He taught us how to be goofy. We all live in an oddly funny world. Oddly funny world. Oddly funny world. We all live in an oddly funny world. Oddly funny world. Oddly funny world.
First name ahead, Mr. Chappelle, are you on? First name ahead, sir. Comedy is coming. It's coming down. Sergeant Comedy. Cut the cable, drop the mic. It's a captain. Oh, captain, my captain.
As we joked about your mama, we were clowning like wild and out. SNL was comedy.
Was comedy
in our oddly a funny world. We all live in an oddly funny world. Oddly funny world, oddly funny world. We all live in an oddly funny world. Oddly funny world,
oddly funny world. Y'all live in an oddly funny world.
An oddly funny world.
Oddly funny world.
We.
Great shot!